I'm replacing the brakes on this Sonata, front and rear on this Sonata. It's 2015 to 2019. This one has the electronic parking brakes, so I'll show right away how to undo that thing. So I will replace the rotors in front, pads, and only pads in the rear. This car has only 25,000 miles on it. It's about 40,000 kilometers, and the pads are completely worn. The front disc, so that's in kilometers, but 25,000 miles. And the front rotors also vibrate on the highway when I brake. So it needs replaced. I did choose Ribestos, I think that's the name, Bendix discs. At the end of the video, if I have a moment, I'll try to show you how to order this from, I did order from Rokoto. The Bendix are pretty much identical. You need to order depending on the trim of your car. I paid for the rotors and pads, front and rear, so just front rotors. I paid 230 Canadian shipped to Canada, so it's very inexpensive. So perhaps let's just start with the rear one. Before trying to replace the pads with the electronic brake, remember to release the electronic brake before you jack the car. First, I want to give you a warning about these screws. We are going to remove the motor, the electric motor, and that's to make place to push back the piston, to make place for the new pads. And people on internet, some say this is a T25 torx screw. That's completely wrong. These are T27 ones. And the thing is, if you try to put the T25 socket on them, you're round inside, you are getting stuck with the screw in there without being able to replace them. You may want then to drill them and to replace the caliper part, not the motor one. But that's another story. So the idea here is that these small screws are covered with rust. And when you try to put a T27 socket on them, it will feel it doesn't want to go inside. So try to maybe to just scratch inside the hole with a nail or anything, a brush, something like this. Try to put some penetrating oil and then get your T27 socket. Get an extension like this, not the socket, because the socket doesn't fit in there. I put a 1/4 socket to grab the extension with the ratchet. And then you don't need to put the ratchet at this moment. Position properly the caliper to sit against the big bolt and just hammer the guy in there. And really, I'm not tapping strong enough. Really give it good kicks. Don't be a worry, it's not gonna crack in there. It's just a metal jack inside. So really tap the guy against and make sure the socket 227 goes deep and stuck in there, because these guys are absolutely stuck by rust. And when you finished, when you feel like it's really grabbing very, very strongly here, then go with the ratchet and just give it kicks like this. Hopefully you are going to release it from there. But that's a big warning. There's a second one on the other side. So really do not put at any moment T25 torx on these guys, and try to get a good bit quality one. Also, don't over tighten this bolt. You want to remove it easily the next time. So to give it just a small snug. It's not, the motor will not jump from there. It's secured already. It's just to keep the motor a little bit in place, but the forces are not on these tiny bolts. And when you finish them, what I really recommend to try, get some anti-seize and really feel the head of the bolt, feel the head of the bolt with anti-seize to preserve it from rusting again and having the same problem within a few years. For the 40 millimeter caliper boards on the rear wheels only, use a 40 millimeter wrench and couple it with another wrench to get leverage, because you don't have access for sockets in there. The way I work is when you need to push back the piston, and my approach to this is to always release the bleeder here. So you push it easier backwards, and also you don't put too much pressure into the ABS system by forcing back the piston with this small bleeder closed. By the way, these are 10 millimeter, are not too tight. Don't force too much on them because you want to remove them easier next time. This tube here, it's 3/8 outer, inner it's 1/4 inch. Now, at the back, I'm not replacing the rotor, only the pads. Let me show you the pads first. So they are really not very well looking. Perhaps if I have a moment, I'll give you a tip on the brand. Let me just see. So stay with me because I have several things to tell you about this. It's Mobis. This is the genuine one. Front also pretty worn. Now, perhaps you already seen a few videos about you need to push back the piston, and we need perhaps the more mechanical way. I'm not sure you can do a programming for the car, put it in maintenance mode or something, but I did undo the motor here. They look like this. Get small solid tips like this and use an extension. That's because the way these guys are placed near the rotor here, if you put the socket, you will put a socket at an angle, and that's the worst thing you can do. This guy round very easily, very, very easily. So buy them new from Hyundai before you start this job. It's about 2 millimeter thick and 17 millimeter long. This is the electric motor only. When you detach it from the caliper, it's kind of stuck in there. So try to insert the butter knife, but insert it only here. Sorry, only at the screws, because you'll have a seal, so you don't damage that seal. And that seal, I suggest you lubricate it with silicone grease only. Let me show you. So this is how it looks. And you have this seal right here around. So put some grease on it because it's exposed to water. So right now I'm using here a T40, and I have my clamp. Maybe you can try to push it with your hand, but better not. So the way this goes is I did open this bleeder a little bit, not too much, just enough to see the fluid go. And then I'm going to turn here, maybe 1/4 of turn, and then I'm going to depress this guy. And you notice the fluid is pushing out. Let's try it again. So it's a repeating process. Turn here 1/4 turn, and turn here until it stops. So let's just try. If you feel this guy doesn't turn, it's because you are pressing here too much. So release the pressure on the piston and turn it by hand. 1/4 turn, not much more. And then just rotate here the clamp. And by the way, careful with the clamp. Don't damage the seal. Watch out where you grab it. So I'm rotating here and you see the fluid coming out. And at the same time, the piston is moving back. So I'm going to push it back all the way. See how much I pushed back the piston. Basically, it's sitting flush with the rubber seal around it. So that's how much you need to push it back. And you should be good to go. Before replacing the motor back, you know you need to match the splines. So just rotate the motor a little bit. And right now, let me just put back the... So these are the new pads. It fits perfectly. Side note, it's just too tight in there. This will cause them at some point to get stuck and wear very fast. Look how nicely they fit in there, and they just move very, very easily. Not loose, but it moves easily. Perhaps you need to do this at the front brakes as well. The same exact problem with the original pads. At some point, I tried to check them and they were so stuck in there, it was unbelievable. So I think the problem is with the measurement of the caliper. Hyundai perhaps, some engineer there missed a few tiny fraction of millimeters here, and it's a little bit too tight, and that may be true for any replacement or genuine pad. So check it out. Just need to tighten back these guys, which are really, really annoying. Basically, when you tighten these guys back, they are very hard to start for some reason. So basically I keep it one hand here, and with my left hand I lined it and I pull this guy all the way to touch here, so otherwise it won't catch it, and also align it, center it properly, and then you are going to get it easy. Otherwise you are going to fight with this guy. I did so. You don't need usually to keep it here from rotating, just put the 40 millimeter sockets. At the front, the disc is secure with two bolts. I don't have much light here, it's inside the garage. You have these two Phillips bolts which go into in the two holes here. You need to use a socket, a big socket on this. Don't try with a screwdriver. They are not too tight, maybe tight, but usually I'm not too tight, but you don't want to strip them. And again, at the front, we have the bracket, has 17 millimeters, two big bolts. They look like this. If I find the torx, I'll put them. And also the 14 millimeters, which secure the sliding pins. And again, try to lubricate these pins. I use a Volvo grease. Let's see. It's silicone grease. It's excellent. I've used other silicone grease by the past, and they tend to get sticky after a few months. This one does not. It's expensive, but it's well worth it. When you put the small pads here, there's a small trick. You have these small metal tabs, and you have to, when you place the pad, you have to push the tabs, push against them just like that, because if you just try to place the pad like this, it's going to be blocked by this tab, so basically insert it on one side and then push the tab on the upper side. I'm doing this one hand, so push against this tab and only then slide it into the hole. By the way, I have troubles with these pads. They really feel like they are really tight in there. So check my link. I will link you a video at the end of this one. See how I grinded a little bit here to have them move a little bit free. You also have brake wear indicators, the one that make noise when it's... and by the way, these are kind of thin. Huh? It's not too much material on them. I'm not sure why, but on my Volvo, there's much more material. Anyhow, this wear indicator goes onto the piston side. So inside is the pipe that stays inside, because this small metal thing will sit like that, and the other one doesn't have the indicator, will sit outside. So careful, otherwise this guy is not going to fit on outside. This is pretty much also. I did add a little bit of anti-seize here around. Don't touch the holes, you don't want to put them on the bolts, and inside here, because it kind of feels like it's getting stuck. And also when you try to remove the old disc, maybe just punch it with a piece of wood like this on one side to make it drop from there. Make sure to suspend this caliper, don't let it hang on the brake hose. And by the way, I want to show something, because I was looking at the suspension, and if you notice right there, these are weldings on the suspension, and these are started to rust pretty badly. There is a bottom one too. If you look at your car, check it out. I would recommend you put some coat of paint or something like that, because it's kind of worrying to see this as early as maybe 2 years old. Okay, so this is how it looks in front as well. Put everything back in place. You have these two screws here. Don't over tighten them, because they are kind of small. And also when you try to match the hole, you need maybe see if the hole matches, otherwise rotate the disc 90 degrees to match the other hole. Only one will match at a time. These 40 millimeter bolts here, careful not to over force on them, because they are aluminium. C2 bracket bolts if you are replacing the disc. Again, they weren't overly tight actually. The torx, if I can find it, I'll post it, but don't force too much on them, because these are also alloy ones. Notice how I turned the wheels so I can access these guys here with my breaker bar. Otherwise, so it gives you an area to work. Okay, just a drive test. The brakes are fine, but especially there's no vibration whatsoever on the highway when I brake. Let's just give it a try. Zero. So the old genuine original disc were definitely wrapped. They were causing vibrations. So yeah, hopefully these ones, Bendix ones, will last longer and just be better quality altogether.
I did order my parts from rokoto.com. It's perhaps very confusing here, and perhaps you may want to try other sites. And also, I think it's important before placing that order, just ask the site, confirm it fits your car model, year, equipment, and so on. Basically, for that Sonata Limited 2015, it looks like for the front discs, let's just start with the discs. Front discs come in two sizes, depends on your equipment, wheels, and so on. And rear discs are perhaps the same size, but they depend, the order depends if you have electronic parking brake or manual parking brake for the rear disc. For the front disc, it will just be two sizes. It doesn't depend on the electronic parking brake or not. Now that's for the disc. If you are looking, let's just try this brand Centric because it's telling a little bit more clear. It looks like Centric has a front disc 305, and it doesn't matter the rear brake or rear parking parking brake control, electronic parking brake. And that's the second larger side for the size for the front disc. And again, it doesn't matter if you have electronic parking brake or manual one. And by the way, when they say electronic parking brake, they have several expressions like this one. It's electronic parking brake. They call it with park brake control. Other places it says with electronic parking brake, the same thing. And manual one, it will say without park brake control, or sometimes they will say manual parking brake. So a bit confusing. That's for the front disc. The rear disc will depend, rear one will depend only if you have electronic parking brake or not. So that's how they say. If I can find one Centric, let me just see. Centric, here go. Rear, it says this one, this rear disc, it's for electronic parking brake. And you notice it doesn't matter the size of the front one, front disc. And for the one with electronic parking brake, it's another number for the rear disc. And again, it doesn't matter if the front one is larger or smaller. That's for the discs. For the pads, now let's just go here. Front pads obviously will depend if you have the larger discs or the smaller discs. Rear pads will depend if you have electronic parking brake or manual parking brake. That's how you order. That's how I understand this. I'll let you read through these options.
This is pretty much it for that.